So now we have the basics of parameters behind us, report parameters and query parameters. Let's take a look at different scenarios of working with parameters. Let's start with adding an all item, look at multi-value parameters, cascading parameters, one of my favorite topics actually, yes. The parameters built-in collection and how we can automatically configure parameters with the assistance of designers. So let's start with the all item. Now, the example here is that sometimes we want all salespeople and other times we want a single salesperson.
Right.
So you just need to do a little bit of manipulation here. Knowing that the available values is being sourced from a query, you can see here the query is in fact a union of two select statements. And I've highlighted here that the first select statement is introducing an artificial key.
That's right.
The minus one doesn't really exist in the employee table, but we're going to add it and we're going to give it a label of all salespeople. Then we union it with the query that returns a list of all the salespeople. Now that's step one. That will add the item, but you need to be prepared in the data set that's retrieving the data for the report, that what's it going to do when it retrieves minus one? Mm-hmm. So the where clause that you see here is that there is a filter on the employee key equals the query parameter employee key, or employee key equals minus one. What will that do at query time, Chris?
Well, that'll give you the option to go and select either all employees or just an individual employee.
Right. So from a filter point of view, if the employee key is minus one, because there's an or there, it's going to return all of them. Mm-hmm. So it retrieves the result we want, but for anybody that is a SQL expert, they might be a little alarmed by this. Do you know why?
I know why, but I'll let you explain. I'm not alarmed by it.
Paginated report bid, do you know why?
No, please tell me.
All right, that type of where clause is going to force a table scan. For a table of a couple of hundred rows, I'm not concerned.
Not a big deal.
If it was a massive table, I would be concerned. But it does raise that the way we would deal with this more optimally is to use a store procedure.
Yes.
Instead of a select statement, what we could use is a store procedure that has branching logic, mm-hmm. that if employee key is minus one, then you're going to use this statement, which has no where clause.
That's right.
Otherwise, you're going to use this statement. So there's another benefit for using stored procedures in this scenario. It would overcome a potential performance issue.
Yeah, you always have to be careful when you're good. Because with paginated reports, you're going directly against the database, I think you have to be careful that you don't do things like this, because you do have the access to the query editor to go and create those SQL queries by hand.
All right, next topic. Another common thing to do is that we're not just interested in all or one, we would like to make the selection of which salespeople that we'll include in the report. So there are two steps to this configuration as well.
Yes.
The report parameter itself must be configured to allow multiple values, and then we have to think about what happens to the query parameter. Now, you can see in the example here that the employee key is in, and the in operator, mm-hmm. When you present a delimited list within parentheses.
That's right.
Is really just an or.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and so that will produce the result we want. What's interesting to note is that Power BI will take your multi-selection and push a comma-separated list into the query.
That's true.
Okay, and so that's how we can achieve multi-value parameters. To my favorite topic of cascading parameters, whereby in the example you see here is that the user would first select a sales territory group, and then based on that selection, the next parameter would filter down to the salespeople in that group.
Right.
All right. So this is a great design, especially where users need to narrow down. And there could be potentially thousands or millions of salespeople or customers. And you can just have as many cascading levels as you need to refine and then target the individual selection.
It's interesting. I was talking to some customers about this, and they actually look at it like it's a wizard. You know, I want to guide right. the users at runtime on exactly what they need to do to get the result they need.
And I think Paginated Report Bear would be very impressed with the point that wizards also have a part to play in report usage.
That's true.
So they're relatively straightforward and quite logical when you think about it, that the available values are driven through data sets in your report design. And so what that means is there's a relationship between, mm-hmm. let's just say in the example of the salespeople, there's going to be a query parameter of what sales territory group they come from.
That's right.
And when there's a mapping from the first parameter into that data set, the report rendering knows automatically that it cannot even populate the available values until the sales territory group has been selected.
Exactly. It'd be like if I was choosing a country, if I chose the United States, I'd want to expect a collection of states to come next. If I was choosing Australia, however, a collection of the states from the US wouldn't make any sense.
Indeed. When I first learned this many years ago, I thought this would be a programming thing to do. And yet it's really just well-crafted queries.
Exactly.
And the report rendering just looks after it automatically. Now, it does require, as this slide points out, that the parameters are in the correct order.
Of course.
You can't ask for salesperson first and then ask for the sales territory that they belong to. All right, so you'll see in the report data pane there is the ability to move up and down. And in fact, in the parameters pane, just by moving them up or down, that resequences them as well.
That's true.
Okay, so it's not possible to have them in the wrong order. It'll be exactly in the order that you present them in the parameters pane.
Yes.
All right, next to the topic of expressions that want to work with report parameters. So I've already pointed out in the available values, we have the concept that a parameter has a value and a label.
Yes.
Whereas the value is usually some database key and the label is something more human readable.
Yeah, something like select blah from this list.
Right. So to get access to these programmatically, you have the parameters collection, you have the name of your parameter,
yep.
And you can refer to the value or the label property.
Mm-hmm.
Now, things just get a little bit interesting when you've switched your parameter to become multi-select.
Yes.
So the value and label properties still exist, but they in fact return arrays. An array is really a collection of like items. So it is a multi-selection of keys. You'll get the value array, and you'll just have to work differently with this array.
It becomes a little bit clearer to understand once you start using URL parameters, because you have to articulate each of the parameter values you want to return. So then it becomes a little bit more understandable.
So we often work with expressions with parameters because remember the subtitle that has been added to the report template?
That's true.
That when users filter by, you know, any number of values, it's very important that you output them back in the report design itself. Otherwise, that report could be printed, distributed, and the context of what filters are being applied are unknown. Now, that's going to introduce uncertainty and mistrust.
Of course.
All right, so certainly these expressions will allow us, the label property, to convey back through like the report title or subtitle what the selection has been. So let's take a look at some examples. If your report parameter is single select, then it's straightforward. From the parameters collection, exclamation mark, the name of your report parameter, dot either the value or the label. If you've switched it to multi-value, you can first of all test it. The is multi-value turns true if it is multi-value. Although I'd hope, because that's a design time property, I'm not sure why in an expression you would need to question it. The count would tell us how many items are selected. The value and label, notice the N within parentheses, meaning that there are arrays and we can request an element from the array.
Yes.
Now, if you need to take a selection of multi-values that are delimited, I'm using my example of the split function here. This would be useful if you wanted to set a default that said for these three keys, they are selected. So what the split will do is take a single delimited string, and it will, based on the delimiter you specify, produce an array that then could be passed into the default. Therefore, we have a default of employees 286, 282, 298.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, now join is the opposite. You give it an array, in this case, the value property of the employee key parameter, and we tell it to return a string that is comma space separated. And this would be ideal in the subtitle of our report.
Yes.
So we could show the multi-selection.
Yeah, which values are you actually bringing back?
In the report page. When it comes to parameterizing with the query designers, we introduce these in module 3. When working with a relational designer and already demonstrated that when you have an applied filter, it's a simple, really simple matter of checking the checkbox to say parameterize it.
You'd think it's simple, but people often overlook it.
And perhaps the reason they overlook it, it's doing much more than just parameterizing the data set.
Right.
All right, so what it's going to do, yes, it injects a query parameter into the statement that it builds, but it also adds a report parameter, and it maps that report parameter to the parameter of the data set.
Yeah.
So it's all wired up. All right, now you might want to modify it if you say, but I want to filter the data set, not parameterize it.
Exactly.
In which case, you remove the parameter, don't parameterize it, and apply a filter from the report parameter to the data set.
Yeah.
Okay, so it's a reasonably straightforward thing to do, and I love the fact that it just does everything you need, and then you're just going to tweak it by maybe changing the prompt of the report parameter or other things. When it comes to the analysis services query designer, we've got parameterization here as well.
Yes.
So in the filter pane, and sometimes you need to scroll horizontally, sometimes by default, depending on the size of your window, it's hidden from you. But if you horizontally scroll, you'll see the parameter column there, and you can choose to parameter any of your filters. There's a special requirement if you're working with the DAX query designer.
That's true. Yes, you need to ensure that the multi-value selection in the toolbar is enabled. It should be on by default for you, but just double check in case you've accidentally jostled it previously. And that will allow you to then use multi-value parameters with DAX, which is a unique thing that you can do with Report Builder.
Awesome. Well, I think it's time for a demo.
Oh, great. I'm looking forward to that.
Stay tuned for the next video.